way most of us do loan division is a solid algorithm. It does work. Easily 50% of the people get it wrong. You have to memorize it. You have to do every single little step right. There's a lot of steps, and most people do it wrong. We're trying to teach your kids to have a strategy that they can use, but the reality is, after fifth grade, we are dealing with such numbers that we would all grab a calculator. We've got tools out there in the world that are good for us, so we are teaching them the importance of estimation, because we can punch into the calculator so wrong so easily. So we have to have an idea of what the answer should be. Doesn't guarantee that it's going to be correct. It can still be off by a few numbers, but magnitude, it's not going to be off by 10,000. So these are the skills we're teaching our kids. This is a fairly long unit for fifth grade. I am only going to touch on a few areas. I'm going to tell you, your kids right now are practicing and understanding how you can multiply and divide by powers of 10. That's that shifting of the decimal point. I can multiply 3 times 400. I can take that 400 apart. 400 is the same as 4 times 10 times 10. So I can multiply 3 times 4 is 12. Multiply by 10, get 120, multiply it by another 10, and I have 1,200. It's not just counting up the zeros and adding them. be around $100,000. Still is in the ballpark, so we have an idea. Our students will be required to do that. We hope they internalize it and make it a skill for the rest of their lives. In class, your students, your kids are building these problems. They've been building multiplication problems while they've been building since kindergarten. They've been building multiplication problems in third grade. At fourth grade, they really went to multi-digit. I'm not going to have us do it because of the amount of time that we have this morning. Plus, your kids don't get this very long in fifth grade. It's a refresher for them. So I gave you a picture with a shadow. Products. I'm going to multiply 2 times 4. they move it along to larger numbers. The truth is, bigger numbers really aren't more difficult. They're just more work. I'm looking at the clock. Shall we do?
Yes.
Why don't you all?
Want to be nice.
Here's four more you can practice at home. What I'd like you to do is look at the next page. One of the big differences between fifth and fourth grade is the multiplication, division, and decimals. So, how is this going to work? A moment ago, with whole numbers, we estimated, we did the arithmetic, we double-checked. The beauty about math is multiplication is the same. It's the same whether you're using whole numbers, it's the same whether you're using division, decimals, and it's the same when we get to fractions later in the term. Let's estimate this. 6 and 8 tenths times 7. I would like to do 7 times 7. My answer should be around 49. I'm just now going to do the simple arithmetic. At this point, I'm not worried about the decimal point. I'm just going to do the multiplication. 7 times 8 is 56. 7 times 60 is 420. I get an answer of 470. Is that close to 49? No, but I have to go with my decimal. If I put my decimal here, it's not close, so that's wrong. If I put my decimal place here, is 47 close to 49? If I put it between the 4 and the 7, I have 4 and 70 hundredths. That's not as good an answer. So 47 is my correct answer.
6. How do you know the 6?
Oh, thank you. 47 and 6 tenths is my answer. Simply using my same strategy as before tells me where to place the decimal. Let's do the one below it. 1 6/10 times 2 3/10. I'm going to say 2 times 2 equals 4. My answer should be near 4. I now do the arithmetic, the multiplication.
To them, like, where are you supposed to be putting the decimal point and why? How do you explain that to them?
Through the same thing, through the estimation. My answer needs to be near 49. The only place I can put that decimal point to be near 49 is at 47 6/10.
So is it that they have to be estimating all the time?
For them?
I'm supposed to.
No. Let's keep going. I'm going to show you what develops. This is what we talk about, kids developing their understanding and developing their knowledge. I would say, yes, everybody in this world should be estimating to use calculators so much. So by the end of this, they have two strategies to use. And I'll be honest, by the time you get to, I don't know who does these problems, yes I do, biologists. When you get into very minute numbers, where you have multiple zeros behind the decimal point, estimation doesn't really work. And this is where the pattern comes in. We do get there, we just develop it, we make them see how it came to be. So we will be expecting them to explain why estimation works. Why? And showing us how they use it. Let's go to the 8/10 × 3/10. Because this really is, in my brain, turns out to be 1 × 0, so my answer needs to be near 0. It's a very uncomfortable place for most people. We expect an answer and somehow 0 doesn't seem right. But it works. So we've got 24. Well, if I put my decimal place here, I'm better. If I put it here, it's even better. If I try to add a 0, I've actually moved further away. Can't imagine somebody really trying there. The strategy can still hold. Now again, once they've noticed, oh, it's two place values behind the 0. Or put behind the decimal point, they can figure this out. So they'll be doing this. Now they will have also built it. I would love to take 3 hours with you and show you how multiplying tenths turns into hundreds. If kids get to do that, and I just don't get 3 hours. So it's a very cool way to even show it first, because that is not something that is innately normal to kids. If I multiply tenths, I end up with these numbers. But we do prove it to them with the area now. The counting of the decimal places, the behind it, this memorization technique. You can think of all the things we memorized that I couldn't access now. Or worse, I accessed them jumbled. But yeah, if they're struggling with that, just keep asking the same question that they start saying and answering it the same way each time. Oh, that's what happened with the desktop. Last year in fourth grade, five groups, that has a value of 90. I have 51. I can go down to two groups, back to 36. And now at 15, I don't have any more whole groups. Students, if they've been in the school, have done them. They were going to start off at the fourth grade level question. I knew my time today, so I jumped into the fifth grade level. So now, I have 30 groups plus 5 groups plus 2 groups is 37 groups, and I have 15 of my 18 remaining. I guess they can get to this picture, they can then solve it. Without the picture, honestly, most kids would take 48, you start multiplying it by 3, then they would multiply it by 2. I don't know what they would do with minus. This is the importance of modeling. It's when the problems get more difficult. When we're first teaching it to them and the problems seem easy, it might seem a little silly. We're trying to get them into a habit of finding the visualized scenario. So as I said, this would be a child definitely proved they understand modeling. Communication and reasoning is the math, the arithmetic they solve. Can't spell today. And then the problem solving, which this one is a problem solving because there's multiple ways of doing it, is did they get the right answer and did they prove that it was reasonable? And again, that's coming back to what should this question read? How many pages did they all read together? The question could have been, how many more pages did Julie read than Mike? Could have asked all sorts of things. So that last piece of are they answering the correct question? This has been the big change in our curriculum, is getting to this modeling and this visualizing of the problems. I would like to take you back to the second page now. Break it apart. 8 times 8 is 8 times 5 plus 8 times